People have been issued with FPNs for what they maintain are trivial matters. Obviously, it's very difficult to you know, on that sliding scale, when does something cease being trivial, and I appreciate that. But there are also allegations that people who are vulnerable have been approached by the Kingdom and issued with notices. Can we have an assurance that people who litter accidentally are given the opportunity to pick up the litter, and that those who are vulnerable are not unduly harassed?
Thank you. I said earlier that we completely operate, we ensure the contract operates within government guidance, and that is the case. And I think some of the issue that I'm hearing tonight might stem from the fact that I believe that a cigarette that is thrown on the floor is not a trivial matter. And it sounds like, without putting words in other people's mouths, that when it's not considered real litter by Councillor Gilchrist, it sounds like that's not a shared view of this council. And my view is that if, and I mentioned before that my niece didn't think part of anyone's children, grandchildren, or themselves, picking up a cigarette to be discarded, I don't think is a trivial matter.
I think wasn't actually talking about cigarettes.
I think it's disgusting, and I think it should be tackled, as do I think with all litter. So, but to give you the reassurance I think you were looking for, as I stated in the answer to the very previous question, the contract operates completely with government guidance.
I just clarifying some things I asked earlier. When we did have Kingdom here last year, we did have a committee, and questioned them on the work they were doing and that. I did say to them, you know, if we identify particular places, would you go and monitor those and look at it? And to be fair, three of the places I actually mentioned, two of them are in Upton, and one was in another part of the world. There was a lot of work done there. So, you know, and I did remember them saying also that if councillors wanted to get in contact with them, to just, you know, have their email address, and I think they sent out a report to everyone. So it was that. In regard to litter and that, certainly in the area I represent, we have church groups for collecting litter. We also have school children, secondary school pupils who are collecting. So a lot of litter collecting is going on in the area. And for example, the school children get we get awards for community work, whether it's visiting people or doing that kind of thing. So I would think that certainly in Upton, litter is collected by quite a number. Cigarettes, though, are not collected by youngsters or by the church groups or that. So, you know, when Kingdom do come into that particular area, I would imagine it would be seeing perhaps more of that, and that hence the reason why perhaps we've got a lot more sort of fines for cigarettes. But that's just my thoughts, really.
Tony. Thanks, Councillor. You say in your reasons for recommendation that the scope and the specification of the new contract have been revised, and you probably answered some of that already. In your reasons for recommendation, the scope and the specification of the new contract has been revised. You probably answered some of that already, but can you embellish that a little bit? Yeah, on the bright side as well, I met with Kingdom. Oh, sorry. I met with Kingdom in Bevington, specifically about dog fouling in Bevington Village and High Bevington, and they were open for further, you know, meetings to concentrate on a certain area, about a certain type of litter, whatever. This occasion was dog fouling, not cigarettes, although cigarettes are a big problem. It's good to see that you've looked at the previous contract. I hope that you've listened to other people's opinions. Listen to everyone else's opinions, and that's been sort of written in and developed in this new contract.
Yeah, thanks, Councillor. The one thing I mentioned before is that there's an extension of those hours, so it starts earlier and it finishes later. And I know one of the problems that have been mentioned when we did get intelligence is a resident would phone up and say, well, they come at 6 a.m. and then they just leave all the dog and walk off. And we were in the position of, well, unfortunately, our contract doesn't cover that. So, sort of going 24 hours, I think this is a really positive step to extend that. But in addition, I think forgive me for not knowing the very specific wording in the contract, but some of those buildings where I think about 50% is roofed, if there's a no smoking sign up there, that is included in the contract. People throwing litter from cars previously wasn't included, but it now is. And there are a few other examples along those lines, which I'm sure, I think we've got Andy McCartan speaking later as a witness, I'm sure he could give you far more examples than I've been able to. But I think some positive steps that have absolutely been based upon the evidence given by councillors, the requests given by councillors and from residents, and I think that's the way that this needs to operate. I'm pleased that we have done.
Councillor Ellis.
Thank you, Matthew, I think you're doing a very good job actually in a very difficult circumstances. But I'd like to know, are you able to sit down with Kingdom representatives and tell them the things they shouldn't be doing, that they are doing? We're going to get witnesses here, I'm sure, to tell us about the things they shouldn't be doing, but they're doing. And I asked this question because of a case study I was involved in about 6 weeks ago. I had a lovely resident in West Kirby. She was out on a litter collecting exercise in West Kirby because she was a litter collecting group. And she was tackling a planter and she got all the litter out of it. But there was one cigarette end in it and she didn't touch that because she wasn't sure what to do with it. She thought it would rust in the ground and there wouldn't be a rubber. She didn't know there was a Kingdom lady hovering behind her with her hand over her uniform so she couldn't be seen as an officer. And she pounced on this lovely lady and gave her a ticket for a fine. Now, we then went through a process. She came to see me in the lane. About four or five concerned residents were residents. Especially those involved in the litter picking group that she was in, wrote to Kingdom and asked them, told them what the circumstances is. And on every case, they said, no, you've got your file, and there's that. She contacted me, and I wrote to her as a local councillor. I don't know whether being a local councillor helped, but anyway, they then responded. And they said they would withdraw the notice. Now, is it possible for you, Matthew, to sit down with us, you know, or get your officers to sit down and get them to agree what are the things they're not supposed to do when they're working for us? I mean, they're working for us. They're not here to do what they want to do. And could we not stop them from doing silly things like that and giving somebody a ticket who hadn't even dropped the litter? She had just not picked it up. She was ludicrous. So, are you doing anything, or what can you do to train these officers to behave more sensibly and more caringly?
Thank you, Councillor Ellis. I hope the whole committee will appreciate that I can't give you chapter and verse on very specific cases. It's right that they come before me, but I know that Rural Council, unlike many other councils that have a similar contract, we actually have an additional stage in which we can do part of that review. I believe some other councils, where they have a contract, if you're not happy, just go straight to court. Or at least with us, there is a step in which the council will look at it, and if the council is unhappy, or believes for another reason shouldn't have been issued, then that can be communicated to the Kingdom. You ask us about sitting down with Kingdom. So I myself have now had two conversations with Kingdom, one on the phone and one face-to-face, in which we've discussed issues that have been raised with me. But I suppose more importantly than that, our officers have at the very least a weekly meeting, and it's often daily, in terms of conversations or sit-downs, to discuss any issues coming forward. So all I can say is if there are concerns, if what you said, and that is completely accurate in terms of that's happening, then that's obviously very silly. And I would clearly wouldn't be happy with that and hope that would be followed forward. And I hope with whoever you raise that, then they can also raise those in any meetings they have with Kingdom.
But they're not doing anything about it, that's just a regrettable.
They're still doing these sort of things, even though they've been told not to be so heavy handed.
So what? I think you didn't turn yours on, I just turned mine off. One of the concerns, Councillor Ellis, I have about this is, I'm sure there will be problems. I don't think it's acceptable to have one, but I understand that if you're issuing 25,000 fines and interactions with residents, that on occasion it's not going to go smoothly or you're not going to be brilliant. We all do make mistakes, and I think it's right, therefore, that the council has a step in which it can intervene and say that wasn't okay. But you're right, and we absolutely need to make sure that this is not happening a single time and it happens no times. That's why the daily conversations happen, because we need to make sure that they get it right. I know we're in conversation at the moment about speaking with Kingdom and checking about additional training about various elements. So I'm happy when I next speak to them to raise the issues you've raised with me.
Okay, Councillor Cox.
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Massacre, again on the same topic, so with regard to incorrect prosecutions. Within our service level agreements with England, are there criteria for when they will be able to prosecute and when they will be able to take someone to court, or is the operational process, is that just left out to themselves? Because I'll give you an idea. This is basically a civil case anyway, isn't it? Prosecuting people on a civil basis. And the reality is, if there wasn't video evidence of me doing whatever I was meant to have done, I'd just tell them where to go anyway, because you have to take me to court and then it's your way against theirs. So the reality is that the prosecution doesn't have quite as much weight unless there's actual video evidence anyway. So it is, what is it? Because in this particular instance that Councillor Ellis has just highlighted, there was no, and I go back to the cigarette butts that Bruce mentioned as well, there was no evidence of that person actually dropping the litter, yet it was on the floor. So therefore, there can't have been any video evidence because she didn't drop it. So what was the basis on which they are happy to go forward and prosecute?
So at the start, I don't really want to get drawn into very specific. He said she's...
It's broader.
Your point is sort of a... Well, she didn't drop it, so there's no video evidence, so it can't go forward. I can't know. I'm not suggesting anything else, but I can't know whether someone dropped litter or not. I can tell you that I don't doubt that the number of people that say it wasn't me. I'm sure that so many people say they don't until they actually, in fairness, realise that is the case. I know that body-worn cameras of Kingdom officers record most of the interactions that are switched on as soon as they see an offence occurring. So on occasions that can be brought forward. In terms of the stage at which it gets to court, I think you said about it's just one word against the other, so it just gets dismissed. My understanding of the 11th...
So it gets dismissed, I said it's one word against the other.
Okay, my understanding, yeah, but then clearly there's other evidence that needs to be brought into play, otherwise it is just that. My understanding is of the 11 times that that's gone to court in recent times, on 10 occasions that's been upheld.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Ashley.
I just had to come back to a little point here. It seems to me that it's quite easy to conflate two things. The one is the contract and the propriety of how we entered into the contract, which seems to me to be okay. I can't find any faults in the way that's done. The second issue, which is a different one, is Kingdom's approach, which a number of people say is heavy-handed and intimidating. Now, I'm sure, I would like to think, that because there is so much evidence, certainly I got a lot of evidence from people who approached me in the local, where I go to have my pint at night. You hear all sorts of stories of people who you trust, who you believe, feel that they've been approached in a heavy-handed way. And of course, it's very easy for people like me. I mean, I smoke a pipe, so at the end of my fill of baccy, there's nothing to throw away. It's still in the pipe, so I put it in my pocket and go home. Now, I don't want to make too much light of it, but people who I know I believe, who I do believe, are telling me that the approach that Kingdom takes is not nice, it's not polite, it's intimidating. What I'd like to think, first of all, I'm quite happy that the manner in which we've entered into the contract is perfectly proper. I've got no problem about that. But I would like to think that we take a much more robust approach in asking Kingdom to take rather more notice of the complaints that we're getting from our residents? That's not really a question.
There is opportunity, Adrian. One of the things you said is we've spent very little time talking about any of the specifics in the call-in itself. This seems to be a frustration some people have or a concern some people have about Kingdom. And I think I said from when I was here last week, calling for a call-in about weeds, my door is always open, my email box is checked pretty much hourly. And if people aren't bringing forward issues to the sub-board officers, then we're unable to then take those forward. On the occasions where they have, I'm pleased that conversations have taken place. I'm pleased that on a daily basis there are conversations between the council and between Kingdom. I said now on two occasions already I've spoken with Kingdom and have raised some of the issues. But I'm also quite aware of the fact that on numerous occasions it's also coming the other way. And that there have been instances as well in which a Kingdom officer has issued a fine and come up against quite severe hostility. And I also think, therefore, clearly that won't make the press, and I completely understand that Kingdom won't have a Facebook group to condemn that. But I think we need to be quite careful about repeating some of the things that we hear on social media or online. We have a full and fair process in which if there are any transgressions, then things will be called up. And I understand it has happened already that when code of conduct wasn't followed, someone was dismissed. I also understand that if there's been the slightest transgression in terms of that conversation, and officers of the council look at this and say, look, you could have done that slightly better or explained that slightly clearer, people undertake additional training. So I think there's actually relatively robust measures on this front, and if anybody has any concerns, they've got to bring them forward.
Okay, final two questions, Christine and then Kate.
Mr. Chair, Matthew, it isn't really a question, it's just a concern generally. I've read the call-in, which is, as far as I'm aware, about the contract. There's a whole different group of subjects we've started discussing about Kingdom and wrongly finding people, whether it's done for money or whether it's done because people drop more litter. I mean, logically, more people, because people smoke large numbers of cigarettes. I think I'm told today 20 a day is the average, and the dog doesn't poo 20 times a day, so you will get more cigarettes and some dog poo. I thought we were here to look at the calling and look at the procedure, and I feel we're going terribly off track at the moment.
Yeah, thank you. You're absolutely right, sir, Councillor Nostradamus. And before we hear from the witnesses, I do have a statement that I'm going to make. A final question, Kate.
My question is along Christine's lines. I think as far as the contract's concerned, are you happy with their governance in the Q&A, basically? And if you are, then that kind of answers everybody's question?
Yes, I am.
Can I thank you, Councillor Patrick?
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
We're going to have some 5-minute statements. 5-minute presentation from witnesses now. But before I call the first witness, can I just read this statement out, please? Because it's very, very relevant to what's just been said. The reasons for the call-in are stated to be doubts as to whether the proposed contract is a suitable means of achieving the objective of a reduction in littering and other environmental offences in the borough. The signatories to the call-in are not maintaining that the successful tenderer is an unsuitable contractor, and therefore the debate and any evidence should concentrate on the suitability of the contractor, not the suitability of the contractor. Okay. Can I call Sarah May?
Chair, you'll forgive me. We were not given notice of that statement in advance. The call-in papers do in fact refer to the way in which the contract might be operated. I would challenge your suggestion that if that really restricts what the people we've called as witnesses might say, and hope we reconsider that matter.
Mr. Chair, the plan just look all but good, Councillor Gilchrist. I said it actually says the process of setting targets and spread of activity from them. And I think a lot of what we've spoken about actually speaks to that.
All I would say is that looking at the terms of the recording motion, we seem to be concentrating on the suitability of the contract to achieve the objective of reducing vitriol. Therefore, concerns about the process are obviously relevant insofar as those processes will be reproduced in this new contract. I'm not talking about individual cases which can be dealt with through processes which have been explained by Councillor Patrick.
You'll forgive me, Chair, it's very difficult to hear Mr. Hughes, and I don't want to try your patience. The fourth paragraph of the...
Can I stop you there, Councillor Gilchrist? Because whilst you had difficulty hearing the officer, I'm having difficulty hearing you, so do you mind sitting down and using your microphone, please?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for that. I'm grateful for your forbearance on this, but I want to draw attention to the fourth paragraph, in which it says, members wish to be fully apprised of the way in which priorities are set, resources are targeted, and employees are directed and supervised. The witnesses that we have instances where the process they believe, and they will show, had not worked well for them, or they believe properly. I believe that is a matter that the committee should be here and ensure that lessons are learned and the new contract does in fact ensure that those concerns are addressed. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, well, I've read the statement. I have taken legal advice and I've read the statement and I'm going to stand by my statement. Can I call our first witness, Sarah Murphy? You have up to 5 minutes, Sarah, to make a statement. You can either read a written statement or feel free to speak off the top of your head, whichever suits you.
Thank you. The statement's going to go against what you just said anyway, so. Right, so basically I'm speaking as a concerned rural resident. I'm also a member of a Facebook group that's campaigning against Kingdom, unsurprisingly. We agree that litter's a problem that needs to be addressed. It's one of a number of antisocial issues we've got plaguing the borough. Neither I nor the group condones littering. In fact, we're vehemently opposed to it. Littering is an offence that can be easily corrected. You know, if someone drops something, it's easy enough for it to be corrected, collected and threatened to dispose of. Could potentially be more or less eradicated through education and also giving people greater pride in their surroundings. Despite our opinions on littering, we are deeply concerned about the way Kingdom operates and the wider social impact this has. I've personally heard from dozens of residents who have suffered at the hands of Kingdom. These reports back up what the official figures tell us. The vast majority of cases, as you know, involve cigarette litter, therefore have a negligible impact on the volume of litter on the streets. The less affluent areas of the world are overwhelmed with the brunt of the penalties imposed. And many people targeted by Kingdom are actually innocent of the crime of littering as officially defined by government guidelines and all clearly fall into the category of being a vulnerable person. This is demonstrated by the low level of court case success for Kingdom, as cases very often seem to be dropped at the last minute. It cannot be right that innocent and vulnerable people are routinely targeted. My plea is to use basis. Even if you think employed Kingdom is helping to reduce litter, given the fact that street cleaning costs remain consistent at an average of £3.5 million per year, same as when before Kingdom were brought in, this benefit is vastly outweighed by the social cost and reputational damage to Borough Borough Council. Firstly, the social cost is undeniable. In the Birkenhead area where most fires are issued, the number of children officially classified as living in poverty is well above the national average and more than double other areas of Borough. This means that thousands of fines have been issued to the parents of children who are struggling every day to provide the basics and may lack the wherewithal to effectively challenge an unfairly or unjustly issued FPM. For such families, an £80 FPM is a very large amount of money. If the fine cannot be paid, people may have no choice but to turn to payday lenders or ignore the FPM, and then the cost of it will dramatically escalate. The potential impact on the individual and their family is enormous. Food bank usage at the start of this year was up by 32% on the previous year. One might argue that this is because of the introduction of universal credits. I wonder how many of more than 21,000 people who've been ticketed by Kingdom since the 1st of July 2015 may be forced to remove money because of an FPM. Secondly, there is clear reputational damage to this authority because of Kingdom's activities. Some high-profile cases have received extensive coverage in local and national press. In times of austerity, where many services are being slashed, the last thing this council needs is an angry public outraged not only by the behaviour of council-sponsored officers, but also by the money they are taking out of our local economy. Councillors, this is the opportunity for you to do the right thing. However well-intentioned the original decision to employ Kingdom, all of the evidence suggests that the impact on visit is marginal at best, while the effects on some of the poorest and most vulnerable members of our community and the reputation of the Borough Council itself is acute. I implore you to listen to thousands of residents you represent and drop the plans for the new Kingdom's contract. If you feel we cannot manage without Kingdom, please consider amendments to the contract. Monitor them more closely, make them a more visible deterrent rather than stalking around covertly watching people. Take some control over them to make them more ethical. Make them more accountable. They currently operate in over 40 councils countrywide with no centralised monitoring. Finally, please reconsider the length of the contract. You're potentially instructing them to remain on Wirral until 2024. The length of the proposed contract effectively gives them carte blanche to carry out bullying and harassing people. It seems to be standard operational procedure wherever Kingdom operate for the officers to make under accusations in order to earn their incentive payments, which they need to earn to make a reasonable wage. Is it really right that a public contract has been given to a private limited company whose employees are then financially incentivised to issue these fines? Kingdom don't care about Wirral's environment or residents. They care about their profits. I hope you care enough about Wirral and its residents to find a better solution to the litter issue than Kingdom are offering.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Councillor Kenny.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Thank you, Ms. Murphy. Yeah, I think you actually said that education will eradicate littering. Well, do you not accept that there are times when enforcement is necessary to prevent littering?
I agree. There are people who deliberately litter, and they do need to be penalised. But the majority of people that seem to be being targeted are deliberately littering. You operate the zero tolerance policy, whereby someone may drop something, the second it touches it to the floor, no matter if they then bend and retrieve it, the fine is then issued. How is that fair? And how does the fact that that happens, like someone drops something, an FPN is issued, and after the FPN is issued, both the offender or the alleged offender and the Kingdom officer walk away and leave that litter on the floor. How is that any benefit to anyone? You know, I do agree that people who deliberately litter should be penalised, but I think the methods that are being used at the moment are unclear.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Can I call our next witness, please? Hello. Sorry, Andrew. Sorry, I didn't see your
hand. Can I just pick up one of the points you made? And tell me if I got this wrong. But you're drawing attention to what you believe is an excessive concentration on the lowest economy areas.
Yes, it seems to be.
And
the case.
You're suggesting that these fines both take money perhaps off the table of the families who receive the fines. You're suggesting that yes, I understand that is what you're saying. And you're suggesting that it's also taking money out of the local economy, because that's money that would otherwise be spent, for instance, on food for the family. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I am.
I thought you were.
That's a nice easy one to answer.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. We call on next witness, please. Eileen McCain. Okay, Eileen, you have up to 5 minutes. It's the middle button in front of you on that controller.
In my case, I have two dogs. One's a large dog and one's a small. And we're on the field. And the man came up to me and told me my dog pooped and I'd long picked up. So I said, I'm sorry, I didn't realise because he was behind me as I was picked up off the bin dog. So I had a dog walking on that anyway. So I said, where? So he said, over there, and there was another man standing there at the back. Gotten this poop that had been there all day for months. It's all dried up. So I said, she hasn't done that, she's not really done it in my garden. You know, it's this. So he said, well, she did do it, we saw it, and there's thorns on it. So, I mean, it was a matter from here to the end of the way you are now. So I picked it up in a bag and I said, that's so cold and dried up. Being able to put your hand on the back of that, which she refused to do. So I ended up, I appealed against the second course on this appeals. And they said that it was told what the officer had said. So I went to court and they said, well, we should look into this more. So we looked into it more and they said, well, we feel that there is a case against you. So I went to court again the second time, said it wasn't guilty. And I asked it. Did they have a video that people were telling me we should have? So they said yes. So I said, well, can I see it? So they said, well, you need to ask for permission to see it. So I did. I went down to see it. And it all shows us. They must tell me the dog had pooped. And I had a big dog. Didn't show me asking, you know, where. And show me where it is. Didn't show me walk up to it. Anything at all. And then suddenly the film went black. And it came back on and showed you green, the green grass and a hand over something like that. So my daughter said, well, that's been tampered with. So they said, it's possibly all tampered with it. So going back the time scale, because it gives you the time to submit, it's things that I had. So she said, no. The lady said, no, you can't be. Well, I'll go away and ask if it's possible. So she came back and said, oh, yes, it could possibly be tampered with. So about a week, maybe 2 weeks before I was due to go back and call in town, he dropped the case. Mm. You know, I mean, genuinely, it wasn't. And there was a dog poop. Nothing to do with it. It was 25 years always picked up. Mm. You know, I mean, I wouldn't put myself through all this. If I was lying about it, I even wanted to go to the doctors. I remember antidepressants still sets me in the house. And, you know, it was like I'd get up over one dog and ignore it. I actually took a turn with me, what they accused me of. But it still upsets me, never. And I mean, I've had people around me in the court saying, why don't we just pay the bail? And otherwise, I'd affect you for half an hour. And I know I'm in the right. Well, I don't see why I should have to. They said they were going to swear on oath. Well, so will I. So what makes me a liar? And then what? It's just ridiculous. I've dogs for 25 years. I've got my granddaughter plays grassroots football, so I wouldn't lead. Dog walk on a field knowing other kids are going on there playing football. You know, it's ridiculous. And yet their way is taken over mine. And until I mentioned about the fact that it had been adopted. They suddenly dropped the case, so they must never have looked at the film anyway. So, I don't think the way you put it is right. I think the victimised people, maybe even my age, I don't know. I was the only one on the field. There's a dog there, or why, you know. But because of my poodle, they decided they'd see my poodle do this. So it was my fault.
Okay, thanks for that. Anyone any questions?
I'm sorry that they're
anyone have any questions? Christina.
It's not so much a question, it's just to say you're not alone. I've heard all the talk about cigarette ends and I hate cigarette ends. And I hate doctors. But like you, I more than one job. And like you, I understand the need test because we all do it. If you've got in the long grass, those who don't have dogs. disgusting subject, but if we're looking for the dog poo, we have to do the leak test because we're picking up other people's dog poo, which sometimes we do if it's on a pathway. We were dog walkers and parents and grandparents do that. I think you're not alone because people may have had other things in their mailbags and emails and things, but I have had three people now who've told me a very similar story to you. And yes, it is. It does seem to be us older people that they get to have those. So whatever else we agree with or disagree with is today, I have to say I do agree with you that, and I can understand how upsetting it is for you that the bus has it.
Councillor Ellis.
And then just a very quick one, I'm sorry to hear, you say that at the third attempt, they suddenly dropped the case.
Yeah.
Did they tell you why they dropped the case?
Just said when
But nothing had changed then, they just decided to pull out, didn't they?
No reason, just so I can only presume that because I had seen the video that they decided they would look into it. They just took the officer's word for it, I presume.
Did you ever pay your expenses?
No.
Okay, thanks, that's all right.
Councillor Fowles.
Yeah, can I just pass on my, if anyone needs to apologise for the ordeal that you've been through. I don't disbelieve a single word that you've said. And it's obviously been a bit of a distress for you, so I am really sympathy. It does, it, in some way, though, highlight why there are less non-file prosecutions given the sort of nature of the gathering of evidence that goes there. And clearly, a mistake has been made here. For which we all apologise. I just, you know, of the 25,000 odd penalties that have been issued, I don't want everyone to believe that this is the case in every single one, because it clearly isn't. But just wanted to, you know, have some sympathy with that. But one or two numbers of cases need to be looked at and need to be apologised to for that. But the overall thrust must be that without threat of enforcement or carrying out of some enforcement, then people will just behave in or won't change behaviour. So I just want to make that point.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Fowles. Can I ask Janet McBride and Michael King, I don't know if you wish to come together or you're going to speak individually. You do as I'm speaking together, yeah? Okay, thank you. Okay, you have up to 5 minutes.
Us a slightly different case. In our case, it was an experienced officer that approached us, and she was training the officer with her. We'd gone to the field. Well, this is my driver. He took me to the field. I've just gone on it when the car pulled up behind us. As soon as I saw the car, I was going to get off the field because I don't normally go on if there's other people or dogs. What happened, the two officers, well, other officers at the time, I just thought there were two ordinary people, got out of the car, went onto the field, behind me, and they were taking photographs. Well, the male officer was taking photographs of the female. So I thought, well, each to his own, I'm going back. As soon as I started going back to the car, the woman chased after me, followed by the man, frightened the life out of me. I got to the car, put the dogs in, and I thought at first that she must have lost something. But she said, your dogs are fouled, you need to, what's your name and address? And I said, my dogs haven't had a chance, I haven't even walked them. And we went backwards and forwards, we were arguing. In the end she said, I'm calling the police, and I thought, great, you know, let the police come. But instead she hadn't called the police, she was just saying she had. So, as I say, he doesn't walk the dogs, I did this on my own. We got in the van, and he was saying, this is weird, don't give your name and address. Went home. When we got home, 5 minutes later, looked out the window, and there she was with the other officer, asking the neighbours, so it was a Sunday afternoon, who the van belonged to. So, obviously they told her it was ours. She knocks on the door with the other officer, and I said, look, I'm sorry, you're not coming in the house, you're too aggressive. I said, you want me to chase after me, just go. I said to the gentleman, and he was all right. I said, yeah, you come in. He comes into the house and I say, look, what's this all about? I mean, the dogs haven't even had a walk. They haven't even done anything. And then she started shouting from outside, danger, danger, get out, get out. Which, you know, we both open the door because I haven't got a clue what she's going on about. And she says, he's not allowed in the house, which I found out later was kingdom policy. So they stayed around for about 15 minutes, because after he went out, I wasn't going to open the door to them anymore. I heard nothing back then. I was quite shaken up, a bit upset. The next morning, she's back, shouting down the letterbox, shouting, Janet McBride, I know who you are, get out, come out, come open the door. Which, you know, I was just carrying upstairs, unfortunately, he was out at the time. And about 2 weeks later, got FPNs in the post. He got one as well. He hadn't even gone on the field, had nothing to do with the dogs. And then we appealed it, went to court. And the clear statement that officer gave was perjury, pure and perjury. I don't get the arrogance of these people, that they can perjure themselves with no respect for the law whatsoever. And I'm only saying this because I can back up everything I say through voice. She did not issue us any FPNs on the field. The dates are different. The supposed offence was supposed to be on the 4th. The FPNs were issued on the 7th. Never approached us in a nice manner. And we know that the Paul Deacon, it was I spoke with, he's got footage and he said that was acceptable, she behaved in a normal manner, giving us the FPNs. And
after that, see the footage.
Oh yeah, we never got to see any footage. But that was, so he'd seen the footage that she was actually outside our house creating, because it's actually written back to me that he'd seen that footage. I didn't think kingdom officers were above the law or could treat people like that. When chasing after me, screaming and yelling at me. Nothing with him, because obviously he wasn't with the dogs, it's only, you know, later that she issued the fines. Oh, that's right, yeah, apparently. We found out in court, I've got two dogs, but the kingdom officers can only issue one FPN. That's why he got the second one for the other dog. But I can't get over the arrogance that, even though she must have known to write what she did, that she'd seen me with the dogs, that they'd defecated in front of her, and that she'd issued us the FPNs there and then. But I had all the proof that total lies. But it's not just me. I mean, I know you're listening, and I do appreciate listening to you, believe me. But there's so many other people out there that you don't get to see how these people treat ordinary citizens that are just going about the business. I mean, it sounds great in theory, everything you do and say, but the reality is not like that, I can promise you. I mean, I can't even explain.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Does anyone have any questions?
Sorry, we did go to court. We did appeal. And because we differed in our views of what had happened so vastly, the magistrate said, go and see the footage, and we'll reset the trial for a few months later. But so we had a few months worrying about it. We tried to see the footage, but nobody would answer us back. And then it was just cancelled due to lack of evidence. But they knew, I mean, they knew what they were doing. It wasn't a mistake. Yeah. It wasn't an experience, as was suggested by someone not even experienced. She was the officer training the other officer. We asked for the witnesses to be in court, because obviously if they'd have been there, we could have said, look, you know, it's issued here and there. It was sent by post, you know, they gave it to us. But they never showed up.
Okay, well, thanks very much for that. Any councillors got any questions for these folks? Steve?
I remember when Kingman came to present to us, the senior officer came, I think I posed, or one of us posed a question about if they